There's still more to be done. Something seemed off, not only with the story she had just told, with her, and with the departed himself. Assuming everything she had said was the truth. Which or not, my mind is made up. Which will strike you first, I wonder? Regret or the curse? You seem to be doing just fine. It's only a tale. The witch is real, very much so. It is not a legend nor a fairy tale. The witch is me. That's right. It wasn't the white-haired girl who claimed to be the witch. And that wasn't all. Or do you mean to reclaim your old self no matter the cost? If you do, if you're sincerely prepared to do that, then be wary of the tale that comes next. Any tragedy that seems too beautiful to be real is precisely that. A fabrication. None of his questions had been answered. He still didn't know who the painting was, or what had taken place long ago that caused the mansion to summon people to it. The departed didn't even know who he was, for that matter. There was still more to be done. He had to find the truth. He needed to find someone. That much was certain. But was the story the maid had told correct about whom? And if it was... What about her? What about the woman whose name he couldn't say? The woman who had so cheerfully called him master? We agreed that we would live together, not just in the same house, so you've got plenty of time to add more to the list. And I hope you can make your own list about me too. This is just the beginning, after all. We've got a long, long time ahead of us. Plenty enough to get to know each other now. He must say her name. He must take her hand. He must make her smile once again. You mustn't reclaim your old self. It's dark. Dark. It's dark. It's dark again. It's dark. Constantly engulfed in darkness. You threw it away every single time. I must break out of this darkness. I'll give you a world that's not cruel to you. I must escape and take her hand. Because that's the reason.
Oh, I've got a wonderful
ideal. Came here.
You can curse them with me.
I must return. I must reclaim.
We can think of new ways to torture them. We'll all
be happier if you stay here. Just think about it. Stay here, in this world. You'll be right at home. No.
I did the best I could for you, nothing more.
This is not where I belong. No matter how much of a world of darkness may suit me,
you'll never be able to do it.
I must reclaim my true self!
This is brilliant. Do you have any idea how terrible the decision that is? Do you have any idea why I fabricated that story? It was all for you. So stay here. Stay right where you are. The darkness suits you better. Remember what someone told you not long ago. That you could handle the stories because they weren't your own. That you were able to bear the tragedies because they happened to others. If that had been your suffering, if the secrets you had kept buried away for so long had come out, You couldn't possibly have endured it. But you're a sharp one. I'm sure you intend to keep those secrets tucked away forever. Do you really think I'm going to let you do that, though? Whatever you try to hide, I'll make sure your beloved hears every last detail. How foolish can you be? Despite all my encouragement, you still insist on getting your old self back. What do you have to gain from that? Nothing but filthy, ugly tragedy awaits you down this path. Don't get your hopes up, my dear. There's nothing for you there. You have nothing. I'm offering you a place by my side. You should just take it. There is no salvation for you anywhere. None. At all. Anywhere. From anyone. Ever. She has long since lost all grip on reality. And you think there's anything you can do for her now? Despite having repeatedly failed to even regain yourself. Well, I suppose if you're going to be stubborn. As much as I don't want to, I have to place a curse on your soul.
That's right. The white-haired girl was never at the mansion. Still a story left untold.
What?
The fourth door was all a lie.
What do you mean?
It was not some sweet little tragedy. The story you told was pure fantasy.
That was the truth. That was where it all began. Because of what happened then, you spent innumerable years lost. Until you showed up here and... What?
The departed reaches out, grasping for it. Pulls himself in. His silhouette, which had been hazy until now, begins to take form. His mind, his consciousness, his heart, his soul, and his body.
Who are you?
The veil in his mind dissipates. A crack forms in the shell encasing him, then another. The invisible shackles chain his spirit fall to the floor. Reality fades in atop the indistinct foggy world around him. Bony fingers appear before his eyes. Long hair. His voice. No. My voice. My body. My fingers. My arms are frail and my joints weak. But despite my resemblance to the white-haired girl, I am not her. This is who I am. I have finally reclaimed myself. You weren't waiting for the white-haired girl. You were waiting for me. And that's exactly why I came here.
What? I have no idea what you're talking about. I have always waited for the white-haired...
There was never a white-haired girl. There was only... This time. This time I must say her name. She is... Giselle. There was only you.
I am... Giselle? No, I am not Giselle. I am a servant of the house. And I am the witch, the cause.
You are not a witch. The witch is someone else. Why do you insist that you're the witch? What changed you so much? The shadowy figure in the master bedroom. That was her. a glimpse into her past. I'm sure this is Giselle, but why is she so different? What happened to the spark she used to have? Where did the light she once shone upon the world go? I have to remember. I must remember. This cannot end until I have. This is no longer a story. No, what I need to face is my past. And her heart. She was not even present in the story she made up. Everything about it had been changed. The past I lived and the wounds she bore were more grounded in harsh reality. Not wrapped in a film of fairy tale magic.
That was the final tale, and it was all true. That's how it happened. It was a bittersweet story.
No. How can you not see this? Yes, it was a beautiful tragedy. But was there even a scrap of humanity in it? Behind the three preceding doors, there had been a constant thread of ugliness and conflicting motivations. But there was hardly a trace of that behind the fourth door. The characters felt like nothing more than characters. Is that what you want to turn into? Is that what you want our history to become?
Our history? Our... But that... But I don't remember anything at all.
You don't remember anything?
No, I don't want to. I don't need a past or a future. All I have left inside me is uncertainty.
Giselle.
No, that's not... That is not my name. Please, stop trying to confuse me. I'm fine with things the way they are. If it means I don't have to hurt, that's all I want. So please, just let me keep being the maid. Let me keep being a guide, not some foolish girl.
Is that what she honestly desires? Does she want to cast aside her past for good? If so, then... No matter what she says, I know I'm right. And if she doesn't reclaim her old self, I'll never get to hear her say my name again. I know I'm being selfish here, but I can't do that. If you're afraid of what you might find, we can remember together. I haven't gotten everything back yet myself. So let's open the real door, together.
There are no other doors to open.
But there is. One that can only open by our hands, because it exists between the two of us. Not a door with physical form, but the door to your heart.
The door...
I grasp her unnaturally cold hand, a hand that long ago once had warmth. If she can't lead the way, then I have to. I must pick up the pieces of our race history, so we can both reclaim ourselves. Find the actual truth. No matter what we may uncover, I will not let go of this hand. No, I mustn't let go of it. Darkness falls over the world around us. The floor upon which we have been standing flickers out of existence, sending us dropping into an endless abyss. This dark pit, this is her door, her history. Let's try this one more time. It's not a sweet story by any means. It's a story of betrayal, anger, hatred. We caused each other pain. But that's the road we traveled. And down that road lies all the answers.
It had been several days since I left the capital, and I could still see it when I closed my eyes. The people lined up on Grand Pont, awaiting entry, eager to start a new life there, brimming with hope. It was a city people were willing to pay high taxes to live in.
If you were a performer, you could get some of those costs shaved down a bit by putting those skills to use. The capital was harsh on those who wanted in, and apathetic about all who left. It was composed of a powerful nobility and clergy, wealthy merchants and bankers, and a large population of poor. And it was the city I had called home for a long time. I didn't know much about where I was heading. It's getting foggy. Looks like it might rain. Maybe we should take a little break. You want to keep going? Oh, all right then. The coachman was frustratingly taciturn. He acted as though he had gotten stuck transporting a prisoner. Though that was hardly a stretch. From his point of view, I was nothing more than a criminal. Even the times he would acknowledge I had said anything, he made no effort to hide the scorn in his eyes. To pretend he didn't regret ever taking this job. And I would just fall silent again. The road was gradually getting narrower. We had long since left the paved city roads behind, and we were now traveling along a couple worn-down grooves in the forest. How did I end up here? Why was I being subjected to this? I was done thinking about it. The more I thought on it, the less fair it seemed. The more I remembered, the worse it hurt. All I could do anymore was close my eyes and weather the storm. Deep within the dense woods, a mansion appeared before us like the world fading into view after a dream. It didn't seem to be an especially large house, but it had obviously been constructed with a great deal of care, and it was, thankfully, not standing in ruins. This deep in the forest? The carriage came to a stop, and the coachman climbed down, signaling with his chin for me to get out. Thank you, very much. You must be tired after such a long journey. This is the mansion I'm looking for, yes? The driver didn't even acknowledge me, getting back under the carriage and setting off into the forest. He seemed to want to get as far away from here as quickly as possible. He could have said something. Oh well. That was about all I could say anyway. Oh well. I couldn't blame anyone for my being here, or for his wanting to get out. I should get going, I guess. Getting a better look at it, the house's windows were, strangely enough, all shuttered. It's probably dark as pitch inside. Does no one live here? But if that's the case, then why was I... I placed my hands on the front door. Such a big door. What if I couldn't get in? I had no idea what else there was in the area. If the door didn't open, then I would die out here in the forest. I've come to accept much, but I was not ready to forfeit my life yet. Please open. It's not locked, I guess. The door was heavy, and though it seemed to protest my attempts to enter, it still opened much easier than I was expecting. I was worried over nothing. Looking in, I got the strangest impression that light was being swallowed up into the mansion's depths. Rather than going inside, it felt as though I was about to step outside the boundaries of this world. When I closed the door, it was so dark I couldn't even tell where I was walking. If the window's open. Though I managed to fumble my way over to a window, it was tightly shuttered and the shutters caked with rust. I was probably not getting it open without a fight. Darn, not a hint of light. I couldn't even see my hand waving in front of my face. It felt as though the floor would fall off from under me and I would sink into eternal darkness if I didn't watch my step. Fighting back that fear, I slowly walked forward, tracing the wall with my hand. There was a door at the end of a long corridor. I pulled it open and a wisp of bone-chilling air rushed past me. It was too dark to see anything, but I could feel something different, present in this area than the rest of the house. Uneasiness gripped me. Hello? Is anyone there? Please don't tell me it's actually abandoned. I suppose I can't know without looking around a bit more. My voice simply disappeared into the void. No response. As I pushed forward through the freezing air, for a split second I spied a shimmer of light. Squinting my eyes, I was able to make out a large window. Unlike the others, it wasn't shuttered. What do we have here? Drapes? I see a little light beyond. My chances were slim, I imagine, but if there was even a slight possibility of getting some light in here, it was worth a shot. So I pulled open the drapes. The next moment, faint but colorful light shone down on me. It was a stained glass window. From beyond the glass, I could hear the subtle pitter-patter of rain. It had finally started, it seemed. The different colors of light blended into a milky white. Dim, but wondrous. It's so pretty. It looks like an angel? Why would someone cover this up? It's beautiful. With a little more light, it'd be... Please do not touch the drapes. Or the windows. Suddenly I heard a voice, and I could sense someone else in the room. The man's voice was emotionless, neither deep nor high. Before long, he came into view illuminated by dull orange candlelight. I'm sorry for coming in uninvited, but, I did announce myself. The man stood there practically blending in with the darkness. Had he been there the whole time? He was staring straight at me. His gaze wavered slightly, but not enough for me to read anything into it. Then again, I could hardly make out any detail at all under the light of a single candle. Is this, your mansion? It is. Thank goodness. I was afraid it was deserted. I suspect you would have preferred it if the house were abandoned. Oh, not at all. I would be scared to death staying in this dark mansion all by myself. I'm sorry. No ill will intended. But I do think it could do with some light. That way you could see where you were walking. And I'm sure this room would look splendid illuminated. Not necessary. I make do perfectly well as things are. How can you see when it's so dark? I have an abundance of candles and oil for lamps. I am not in want of means of creating light. It is not your place to criticize my lifestyle. If you need light, you are free to leave. If you are in need of money, help yourself to some of the furniture. There's a village not far from here. Trade for food, then make your way to a larger town. I am no longer able to freely return to the city. I cannot go back there. Please, don't chase me out. I see. And do you ask this of me, aware of how people refer to this mansion? They say that a witch lives here. Not merely a witch. A cursed witch. If you remain here, you too shall suffer likely. You too shall likely suffer your own destruction. You're worried for my well-being? Witch or not, my mind is made up. I was sent to this cursed witch's mansion to atone for my transgressions back in the city. It didn't matter what lived here, I had no choice. Which will strike you first, I wonder? Regret or the curse? You seem to be doing just fine. It's only a tale. The witch is real. Very much so. It is not a legend nor a fairy tale. The witch. The witch's name was Morgana. Is me. Yes. That was our first encounter. It was nothing flowery or dramatic. It was rather laced with suspicion and wariness. We knew nothing about one another, and I had no interest in changing that. But nonetheless, that was where it all began. Where my history with her commenced. The woman had jade eyes. Open wide, they glimmered like jewels in the light, shining through the stained glass window. She seemed to be at a loss for words. I wasn't lying, per se. The rumor said a witch lived in this house, and I was the only one who filled that criteria. Thus, said rumors could be interpreted to be talking about me. After staring at me dumbfounded for a few moments, the woman suddenly burst into laughter.
Wow! Here I was thinking you were kind of scary, and it turns out you're actually quite funny.
What?
I never would have guessed you were someone to tell such a ridiculous joke with a straight face.
I wasn't.
You don't look at all like a witch. I mean, it's dark and I can't really see, but you seem to me more like a rather handsome man.
The word witch. The word witch has broader meaning than just a woman who practices magic. any unholy person with cursed powers, man or woman, can be considered a witch.
I think I get what you're trying to say, but my mental image of a witch is definitely more a woman. So you're not a witch. To tell you the truth, I didn't know who might be here, which had me rather scared. I think I can make this work.
What do you...
It's a pleasure to meet you, Master.
Master?
I was sent here from your old home. I was an Abigail for your mother, but, well, I might have made a little goof.
I froze the moment the word left her mouth. Home. It rattled around my skull, shaking up terrible memories that almost brought me to my knees. Why, after all these years, were they reaching out to me now? And not even sending someone to bring me back, just sending someone. To what end? For what purpose had they shipped an Abigail out to this remote mansion? What was my mother thinking? Was this another one of her attempts to break my curse? What do you mean you made a little goof? My voice came out weak. I did my best not to let it show my face.
It was a teeny tiny mistake. Nothing you need to concern yourself with.
What did Mother say about me?
Well, it was actually your father who told me to come here. I never really spoke to your mother much.
Father sent you? That made even less sense. Why would he have? Did Father even know I was here? No, if he had known, I would have been... Who was this woman? And what was her goal in asking to stay here?
Well, there you have it. I'll be here for a while. If you need me for anything, do not hesitate to ask. I'm confident I can handle most everyday tasks. Now, where should I begin? I know. Are you hungry, Master? Food. I can't imagine you eat much, being as skinny as you are.
I turned my back on her without responding. No matter what her goal was, she had been sent from that house. There was no way anything good could come of that, and there was no way I could live with someone who had ties to them. I prayed she would take the hint to give up and leave.
Master?
And so I kept ignoring her.
Master! Master!
I ignored.
Master!
I ignored her.
Master, what would you like for supper?
Nothing! But failed, spinning back and shouting. Her eyes went wide and then she gave a sheepish giggle. I glared at her as she fidgeted uncomfortably.
Eating is one of the most basic human needs, so if you're hungry, you should really eat.
I said I didn't want... What was that sound?
Must you ask? That's not a very polite thing to ask a lady, you know. It was a long trip, and all I had to eat on the road was dried fruit. Felt like I was some kind of animal. So, what I'm trying to say is that I'm hungry.
That wasn't the sound of her stomach growling, was it? I thought lightning had struck in the distance.
And would like some supper.
The kitchen is at the far end of the hall on the first floor. There's food in the cellar. Help yourself to any of it.
Thank you so much. I honestly feel like I haven't eaten in days, and I'm about to die of starvation. Oh, and I shouldn't need any help finding it. I plan on exploring the house anyway. It's rather exciting being in a new place.
Damn it. That did not go as planned. Oh well. She can do as she pleases. I'll have nothing to do with it.
Oh, Master, are you sure you don't?
No.
Master, Master...
What is it now?
My name is Giselle. It's a pleasure to meet you. And your name, Master, you!
I actually left the room that time, making my way back to my chambers. At some point, I would seriously have to chase her out. Especially considering she had come from that house. But regardless, I was not terribly fond of her.
I didn't really understand Michelle. But that was probably because we were still essentially strangers. Having been sent to the mansion as reparation for my mistakes, I wasn't sure who I might find there. But I was tentatively convinced he wasn't a terrible person. He didn't do anything to me, except stay away. Michelle spent most of his time in his chambers. which he had told me to never enter under any circumstances, so we rarely encountered one another in the halls. For that reason, I made an effort to be kind and cheerful on the sporadic occasions we did cross paths. I feared if I kept that up long enough, he would eventually warm up to me. And as new housemates, being able to enjoy our time together was obviously preferable to the alternative. If I did manage to break the ice, I hope we would be able to do some talking. About the mansion, about him, about me. I just had to keep working at it. Michel didn't need me to take care of him. He handled his own day-to-day needs and activities by himself. And in fact, he didn't ask me for anything. An aristocrat who had no use for his servant. I hadn't met anyone like him before. All right then. That meant all I could do was clean. I wasn't sure how his room looked, but the rest of the house was, quite frankly, an absolute disaster. The dust was so heavy it was obvious it hadn't been touched in years. Let's get started. It couldn't be healthy to live in these conditions, so I set out to clean each room in the house one by one. That said, it wasn't going to be an easy task. Not because I was bad at cleaning. In fact, I considered myself quite good at it. But because it was near impossible to find all the dust and grime that needed cleaning under the flickering light of a candle. I can't understand how anyone sane can live in this dark. What's wrong with him? Maybe he's actually a vampire. Oh god, wouldn't that be something? I can see it now. Him sneaking out every night to suck the blood of pretty girls. Priceless. That means I'm in trouble. Look at me, Miss One Woman Comedy Show here, yep. If I am able to get him to warm up to me, though, maybe that'll give me a little more room to make some changes. Like opening some windows. No light, no fresh air? No thank you. Anyway, I set the candlestick down, pulled over a chair to stand on, and started wiping down the shelf. The chair's legs seemed to be uneven, as it wobbled slightly beneath me. So many books. I wonder, do they all belong to him? I knew parchment was expensive, so it was rather astonishing seeing this many stacks of it in one place. There were even some books with bulky, extravagantly decorated covers. He does come from an esteemed family. I'd spent enough time in his family's home. It was a constant bustle of servants and guests. The exact opposite of what this mansion was like. Why had he left his home? What had he done to be sent all the way out here to this remote mansion with a less than savory reputation? Need to be careful not to overstep my bounds. I am a servant now. A servant. But once the thought had crossed my mind, I couldn't get it out. I'd always had a bad tendency to chase my curiosities as soon as they struck, pushing to scratch the itch no matter how much my actions annoyed others. I couldn't do that here, though. I was simply a servant, and if I got on Michel's bad side, I'd risk getting thrown out. I wonder what kind of books he's got in here. So I attempted to distract myself. I grabbed one of the books and attempted to pull it out. What? But the strings binding the parchment must have gotten tangled at the back. Whoa, whoa! Because the books on either side tilted back with it. And then the entire row came crashing down on top of me. Ow! Oh, for cripe's sake! I had fallen off the chair and a downpour of books was still coming down on me. A mountain of dust with it. Seriously? What are you doing? What? Suddenly Michel was there, looking down on me from a little ways away. There was, as usual, not much I could read from his expression, but I could hear a vague trace of exasperation in his voice. I was doing some cleaning and... Impressive work. I'm usually better than this. It's just so dark, mistakes should be expected. I really think we should open some windows, Master. Get some light, some air flowing through here. I never asked you to clean anything. You did this entirely yourself. But there's so much dust. It can't be good for you. I am perfectly healthy. I don't see the problem. Had he even seen himself? No way someone that skinny was perfectly healthy. You look like you have something to say. He can make out my face in this darkness? You know, I wanted to be useful and clean is about all I can do here, so, you know. I was sensing something else, but alright. He let out a sigh, stepped over toward the pile of books, and then reached his hand down for me. I suddenly felt a pang of embarrassment about the fact that I was still splayed out on the floor. but I raised my hand up to take his, only for him to pick up a book instead. You could at least help me up.
You have legs,
he said, casually returning the book to the top shelf. Maybe I was wrong. Maybe he was a terrible person. So, Master, are all these books yours? Giselle asked, not a trace of remorse visible on her face despite having made a mess of the room she was supposedly trying to clean. I gave a curt nod. Really? That's impressive. Must have been hard work getting them all in here, huh? There's gotta be 100 books in here. You could fill a whole carriage at least. It's like you got your own personal library. She had been pouting only a few moments earlier, but her smile was back in short order. Her jade eyes were like little balls of curiosity, glittering in the faint candlelight. I was not particularly fond of overly expressive, rather overly curious women. Did they not care that they trampled uninvited in other people's personal spaces? Or were they not even aware that their actions were invasive? I averted my gaze from hers. I receive one roughly every month. I see. Wait! She turned back toward the shelves. I presume she understood the implications of what I had just said, of the fact that there were nearly 100 tomes here and I received only one a month. Huh? Giselle fell silent. I couldn't blame her if she thought my circumstances or my family or my life bizarre. But I didn't care what she thought of me. In fact, it was to my advantage for her to be uncomfortable. I just needed her to stay quiet and keep her nose out of my business. There's more than I thought. I said not to her, but to myself. I had no reason to count the passage of time anymore. Only the book served as a record of how long I had been here. 121? What? There are 121 books. 10 years and 1 month. You were counting. I thought she had just sheepishly gone quiet. What an inscrutable woman. You've been here in the mansion for that long? All by yourself? The truth was, there had been times when I wasn't alone. But Giselle had no need to know that. Already knew the answer. A look of pity formed in Giselle's eyes. Enough. I never asked for her sympathy. I am here by choice. You mean you weren't banished here? No restraint, this woman. No. I came here of my own volition. I didn't care enough to elaborate, though. Picking another book up off the floor, I brushed the dust off its cover. It was a gaudily decorated tome. That's a very fancy book, isn't it? But apparently Giselle was unable to take a hint. What's it about? I let out a sign open to no page in particular, sticking the book out toward her. She was a servant. And a woman. There was no way she could read. Let's see here. This land is hardly suitable for cultivation. It can only produce oversour grapes. I would probably get more out of it if I tore down the fields and made it into a market. Sounds like a lord's diary. You can read. I was caught slightly off guard. It was rare for a noble woman to be able to read and write, let alone a servant. Was she truly what she claimed to be?
I had someone teach me. So is this book any interesting?
It's dull, worthless tripe. I can't imagine why anyone thought it was worth binding.
Tough crowd. But it's not very often you get to see a lord's diary. I'm rather curious what kinds of things he griped about.
Lord or king, what value was there in another's grumbling? There was no knowledge contained within that book. Just emotions. Unsightly scribbles. And there was nothing more exhausting in this world than being emotional. If you want to read it, be my guest.
That wasn't my intention, but alright. Once I've got the whole mansion cleaned, I'll read it.
I told you, you don't have to clean.
I've got an idea, Master. If you're interested, maybe we could read together.
Did you hear a word I just said? It's dull, worthless tripe.
Still, you might see it differently if you read it with someone else. And I'm sure there are some books here you would enjoy, Master.
You're wasting your time. The suspicion and restraint budding between us was trite and insignificant at that point. She was still smiling, after all. If I had been able to maintain that distance, then perhaps I wouldn't have ended up hurting her.
It had been a little under 2 weeks since I moved in with Michelle. Though we lived in the same house, we rarely saw each other. On unlucky days, I wouldn't see him at all. I wasn't sure if he ate in his room or our schedules were simply misaligned, but we never had any meals together. Perhaps he was deliberately avoiding me. That has to be it. I know servant and master don't usually eat in the same table, but even so, he could be a little less obvious about it. Am I really that much of a nuisance? I'm not doing anything inappropriate, am I? I'm being pleasant and sociable, aren't I? I haven't given him any reason not to like me, I think. I hope. He had never been very enthusiastic about my staying here, but I hadn't been given a choice. I had been sent here by his family. Besides... No, out with the negative thoughts. Gotta stay positive. Yeah, he hasn't tried to chase me out yet. I just haven't broken the ice. I had to stay positive, optimistic, happy thoughts, and be myself. As long as I kept working at it, with enough time, Michelle would surely come around and not be so distant. I've got a goal, so let's get to work. First, I make supper, and then I ask him to have it with me. Gotta be proactive when it comes to the reclusive types. Alright, here goes. Or here would go, but we're almost out of supplies. So much for that. The cellar was where the non-perishable food was stored. Dried food, smoked meats, cheeses, and a small scattering of root vegetables. Looking at this makes me feel like a soldier holding down a castle's fortifications. Had Michelle really gone 10 years on nothing but this? I would have raised the white flag long ago. He said he hadn't left the mansion at all in those 10 years. I assume he at least goes out to get supplies, right? Running out of food is kind of a life-or-death matter. I can't believe he hasn't set foot outside even once, and... What are you babbling on about? Oh no, he overheard me. I assumed you were talking to someone. Huh? Does anyone else live here, Master? I haven't seen anyone. It is just the two of us. Alive, anyway. You mean there are ghosts? Something of the sort. There you go again with the jokes. I'm not a child, you're not going to trick me like that. There are adults who believe in such things. I suppose, but I don't really believe in ghosts or demons or curses or any of that. The church just tries to convince people that they're real so they can squeeze more money out of them. Am I going to have to turn you over to the church, you blasphemer? No, no, no. I pray every day, honest. I don't particularly care either way. I'm returning to my chambers. Already? You didn't, come down for food? I only came down because I heard voices. A moment, please, just wait a second. What? Our stores are almost empty. What do you normally do when you need more food? I'll happily accompany you on a trip to the market. Already? That was fast. There are two of us. I really don't eat that much, do I? In the dim light, it was difficult to make out Michelle's expression, but I thought I could see a tinge of annoyance on his face. Hold your ground, Giselle. You said you wanted to get closer to him. Is that a parsnip? Michelle was holding a tangled ball of roots. The reason I asked is because the parsnip looked like it was on the verge of total decomposition. See, there's still food. He then handed it to me. Wait! You want to eat that? It's clearly seen better days. You're going to get sick. Or are you telling me you can survive on rotten vegetables? Of course I won't eat it. I just figured you were hard enough to survive. What do you think I am? No, he is definitely a jerk. Or that the resulting diarrhea might reduce your appetite. You're kidding, right? You can't be serious. Anyway, we should bury that outside. Then we can go purchase fresh supplies. I told you, I don't go outside. Then how do you... visitor? Who could it be?
Perfect timing. You're a servant. Make yourself useful and go retrieve the package. If it's not a delivery but a wanderer, chase them off.
What? Package? Master? Hold on a second. What are you talking about? He's gone. What kind of delivery is he expecting?
Michelle stood there, unmoving, veiled in shadow. He glanced over at me, then threw his gaze to the front door. At his command, I raised the bar, pulling open the door. After nearly 2 weeks inside, the light from the setting sun almost blinded me. The world went white, my head pounding. After a few moments of intense blinking, my eyes acclimated themselves to the evening sunlight. There was no one outside. Only a crate easily large enough to fit a child.
Is this the package? Master?
I turned back to face Michelle, but he wouldn't meet my eyes. Though it seemed more like he was avoiding looking at the light than me. He started to seem more and more like a vampire. Not that I believe in vampires, of course. Regardless, I pray there's nothing bad in here.
That's heavy. Master, could I get some help?
Gee, thanks. I am a servant, admittedly, but this is a lot to ask of just one girl. A little help would sure be nice. Once it's inside, close and bar the door. He said dispassionately, but his head still turned toward the darkness. As you wish, Master. Once the door was shut, I found myself sucked back into a world of darkness. Hadn't even been 2 weeks, but the lack of light was beginning to become my normal. The outside world growing farther and farther away. Being holed up in here is definitely not good for me. I should go for a walk sometime. Maybe plant some flowers or vegetables. Yeah, I like that idea. Maybe I can grow that old tangle of roots into some fresh parsnip. What else do we have to plant? It'd be great if there were some flower seeds. What are you doing? Open the box now. As you wish, Master.
Oh, there's food inside?
In the box was a burlap sack filled with berries, root vegetables, and smoked meats, as well as an assortment of bread, fruit, and wine. Aside from the fruit and bread, everything else was the same as what Michelle kept in the cellar. And buried beneath the burlap sack was a single book. One book a month. He really hasn't gone outside in 10 years. It appears you've begun to grasp the situation.
Yeah, but why? This was delivered by someone from your house, Master, wasn't it?
A servant, I assume.
Why would they leave without saying anything?
No one wants to talk to a cursed man. In the past, they would occasionally check in on me, but that hasn't happened recently.
They think you're cursed?
Right. You don't believe in curses. Then come up with your own explanation. An excuse for them to want to stay away from me. That, for example, I killed someone, or maybe that I'm insane.
I couldn't.
Regardless, I am not normal. Bring the food down to the cellar. The book to the library. You are, of course, free to refuse and run back off into the woods.
I'll do it.
All right. Then you take care of that.
Hey.
What is it?
I just noticed there's something else in here. It's wrapped in cloth. What could it be?
Oh, a painting. For you to hang up somewhere in the house, I presume?
It's so dark I can't see very well, but I'm sure it's...
Don't touch that!
What?
Michel, who had kept his distance from me until that point, suddenly marched over and ripped the painting from my grasp.
Master?
His face was twisted into a look I'd never seen him make before. Was it indignation? Disgust? Hatred? Panic? I couldn't tell, but there was more than enough negative pressure to cause me to flinch back.
Is that painting perhaps, something important?
A landscape painting. He muttered under his breath, the tension melting away from his face. I was left looking at his usual blank, impenetrable expression. But his eyes were still fixated on the picture, staring at it unblinkingly. landscape painting. Some kind of passive-aggressive message. It's not of anywhere nearby. Did they travel somewhere? Well, it's not of that girl, so that's an improvement. Master? Oh, you're still here.
Still here? Of course I'm still here. Who do you think you asked to take care of that package? What's with you? Just running over and snatching the painting from me? You scared me. Could you maybe explain yourself? What's so special about that painting?
I don't believe that's any of your business.
None of my... Of course it is. You ripped it out of my hands like I was some kind of thief. I have a right to know what that was about, and maybe an apology while you're at it. You told me to open the box, so I did. Then all of a sudden you're angry.
We are not equals. Do not mistake yourself for my friend. You have a right to know. You have no such thing.
You don't have to be rude.
I'll say it again. Leave if you don't like it here. I never asked for you to be here. That was your wish.
My wish? Are you out of your mind? I never asked for this. I never wished for it. Who in their right mind would want to be sent to some house in the middle of nowhere? Who would ever want to go through that?
No, calm down, Giselle. You can't get angry.
You're right. That is what I wanted. But I never wanted to make you mad or for us to argue like this. I just wanted to get to know you better. To get closer to you. I mean, it would make things smoother for the both of us. It would make living together more enjoyable for us.
Listen carefully. This is very important for you to understand. Do not try to involve yourself with me. Do not go probing around for information. And if you can't do that, leave.
I... completely shut out. The glare he was giving me and the standoffish aura he was emanating were reflected in his tone of voice. Why? Why did he try to push me away like that?
It seemed Giselle really didn't know much about me. Despite being sent here from my house, she was unaware of the monthly deliveries, as well as the reason why I lived in the mansion all by myself. Why, though, would they not have told her anything? Why had she been sent here? Left completely in the dark. Giselle looked up at me, fear and bewilderment in her eyes, though I thought I could see a glint of suspicion beneath it all. Like her true feelings were bubbling to the surface. Everyone had darkness in them they kept hidden. No one was exactly who they appeared to be. She was undoubtedly thinking, I'm not here because I want to be. I knew from the moment I first saw her that her bugless sweet effect was all a facade. Had she thought I was dense enough to not realize? She was no different than anyone else. What I didn't understand, though, was why she refused to leave no matter how hard I pushed. What was she hiding beneath that innocent-looking face? What was she thinking? What did she carry on her shoulders? Everyone is hiding something, deceiving those around them. I had to figure out what she really was. May I ask you something?
Yes?
On the day you arrived, you said you made a teeny tiny mistake while working in my family's house. Tell me about that. What did you do at the Boulanger estate? In that moment, brief though it was, her disposition wavered. Fear. Terror. No, perhaps anger. I couldn't tell. Nevertheless, it was abundantly clear that that was a subject she had no interest in me breaching. And so she had borne her fangs. The smile she donned was now visibly forced.
It's nothing you need to concern yourself with, Master. I promise it was an insignificant little thing.
She couldn't say. Why couldn't she tell me? What had she done there? What did this woman know about that house? What did she know about me? What was concealed beneath that smile of hers? I am the master of this house, and you are a servant. And still you refuse to tell me.
Like I said, it's nothing. There's no reason to bother you. With a mere servant's personal blunders, Master.
What are you hiding?
I'm not hiding anything. Then you should be able to tell me exactly what you did at the Boulanger estate.
Like I said,
tell me. Tell me.
You won't tell me a thing about yourself, and yet you demand others tell you about themselves? Here you are, practically threatening me. Demanding I tell you something I don't want to talk about? And yet you still haven't told me anything about the painting?
Oh-ho. So I was right. You do have something to hide. How many times must I repeat myself? We are not equals. I don't care if it's insignificant or something you don't want to talk about.
Well,
I'm ordering you to tell me. A trifling blunder would not get someone sent to live with a cursed man in a house spoken of so unfavorably. Whatever she had done at the Boulanger estate, that had something to do with why she was here. If she truly hadn't done anything, then she had something to gain from this place, or possibly from me. And if that was the case, I had to get her to talk.
Don't make me...
Giselle's eyes were open wide. I recognized the look she was giving me. I knew very well what that gaze meant.
You're an abomination.
It was the same as them. Fear, contempt, revulsion, repulsion. The way she acted, the way she spoke, it was exactly the same. You're no different. I made her uncomfortable. I made her afraid. She thought I was unpleasant. She thought I was despicable. She thought I was an abomination! In a frenzy, I grabbed her by the shoulders, clamping down far more powerfully than I had meant to.
Ow! Stop!
Her face, contorted in pain, morphed into someone else's. Who was I directing my anger at? Where was this rage being aimed? Who are you calling an abomination? Tell me! Who? The black fury bubbling up from within me knew no end. The girl, she ridiculed me. She denied my identity with her glare. I couldn't escape from that phantom, that reality.
What are you... I never called you... Get away from me! Get your hands off me!
Giselle's scream echoed in the entrance hall, rattling my eardrums. She frantically smacked my arms aside, and then I came back to my senses. She was staying a little ways away, breathing heavily, arms wrapped tight around her body, glowering at me, showing her opposition to my touching her. Enlightening.
No, you just, you startled me, that's all.
Some servant you are, telling your master not to touch you.
I'm allergic to people. It's a very, very unique condition, I hear. I mean, can you believe that? See, you know how some people get all red and itchy when they touch a dog or cat? It's that, except for people, so... I'm sorry, I wasn't trying to be disrespectful. I beg your forgiveness.
Why don't you speak your mind?
What?
This is what's going through your mind right now. I have nothing to apologize for.
No, that's not...
I can somewhat sympathize with your plight, being made to apologize even though you're hurting. I raised my hand against you first, after all.
Then you, you forgive me?
Sympathy does not equate forgiveness. Now, you take care of the package. I'm heading back to my chambers. What is it?
You're not going to make me leave after what I just did?
No, I am not. For it would seem I can make you leave on your own whenever I so please. Besides, I had yet to learn what she had done. It would be exceedingly difficult to get the story from her own mouth, which left me with one option. To write a letter to my mother, as much as the very thought revolted me. Several days had passed since the package arrived. The end of my third week living in the mansion was drawing near. Michel wasn't getting any friendlier either. He continued to either snub or bluntly dismiss me whenever we crossed paths. I didn't understand why he acted that way around me. But there was little point in asking when he seemed to think there was little point in talking to me at all. Although at first, I'd been sure there was some way to get him to warm up to me. The more time I spent in the mansion, the more my willpower began to feel like it was at its breaking point. I could tell myself to stay positive until I was blue in the face, but it would only work for so long. The one pretty place in the whole house. I'm glad he hasn't covered it back up. Blue moonlight shone quietly through the stained glass window, vainly illuminating some of the room. I hadn't noticed until now, but the room with the stained glass window appeared to be modeled after a chapel. Rows of pews faced the window, below which sat what used to be a pulpit. There was very little left of it, though, and its awkward length of silver was mounted to the pulpit's front face. What was, I assumed, formerly a cross. Upon further reflection, rather than facing the window, the pew seemed to be pointed at the pulpit, or rather the cross hanging on it. I wasn't sure why there would be a chapel in a mansion, but I had no one to ask about it. For a house of this size, a statue of Christ or the Virgin Mary seems more appropriate. It's a very well-made chapel, at any rate. I doubted Michel had built it for himself. There would be no reason for him to cover the window if that were the case. Nor had I ever seen him come to pray. He doesn't seem like one to believe in God. God. I'm not sure if God really existed, then surely the world would be a much more pleasant, peaceful place. No unfair disparities in money or power? No senseless misfortune? I certainly wouldn't have found myself here either. But God was evidently quite fond of giving mankind trials, so he would probably tell me with a straight face that this was one too. Or perhaps, we simply had a false impression of him. And he didn't actually give us anything. He merely sat back and watched from somewhere far, far away. It wasn't his job to bring peace to the world, or ensure our laws were fair. That was all mankind's responsibility. What is God? What are angels? I have no idea. Maybe the Bible has answers. Why should I pray to someone so far away? How do I know my prayer is even getting there? But still, it's not like I have any other options. Don't you worry. It'll all work out, promise. I already know where I'm going to work. It's a really prominent noble house, way out of the reach of some small-time merchant like us. You never know, this could be my big break. I'm just kidding. Don't look so worried. I'll be just fine, honestly. I'll make enough money for us to get back onto our feet. For goodness sake, I can handle it. Leave everything to me. You just wait, I'll make our family into something you can be proud of. I'll be fine. Yeah, say bye to Mom for me. I probably won't be home for a while. What? You're afraid I'm going to make some careless mistake? I'm not that airheaded. I can be a refined and elegant young lady. Those nobles won't even know what to believe anymore. If you don't believe me, how about I give you a little taste? Ahem. How are you doing this fine morning, Master? Your morning beverage is ready, prepared with the utmost of care. See, how about that? Not bad, huh? What? You really think it sounded forced? I was the daughter of a merchant who ran a shop on the capital's main street. My father had passed away in a plague, so it was just me, my mother, and my older sister. It would be a lie to say business was doing well. We struggled to squeak by day after day after taxes. But we just couldn't abandon the shop and leave the capital either. So we tried to make the best of what we were able to take in between the three of us. Then my sister fell in love with a moderately well-off aristocrat. Both my mom and I were supportive of her and her desire to marry. But their union almost fell apart because she was not suitable for him. Merchants were hardly the lowest class. What we lacked instead was wealth. We needed another source of money beyond what the shop took in. If only we had money, my sister could get married. If only we had money, my mom wouldn't have to work so hard. If only we had money. It was then that someone from the distinguished Boulanger estate approached me. He said they were in need of Abigail's and would love to have me. He said that if I agreed to work for them, the Boulanger estate would take care of my family. Generally speaking, noble houses took Abigail's from other lower-ranked noble houses. It was unthinkable for someone of my status to receive such an offer. so I took it as a once-in-a-lifetime chance and accepted the offer. I just pray that nothing bad happens to my sister, and that Mom is getting enough money to live comfortably. That's all I can do. They're nobility. They have plenty of money. Enough to spare some. The light shining through the stained glass window began to grow murky, fading into blackness. It felt like a message from on high, that no, my prayers would not be answered. The bluish-white illumination shining down upon me disappeared as clouds blocked the moon. Oh, come on. You don't even want to look at a sullied woman like me? Oh, for heaven's sake. I never asked to end up like this. Their nobility. They have plenty of money. Enough to spare some. Oh, come on. You don't even want to look at a sullied woman like me? Oh, for heaven's sake. I never asked to end up like this. Giselle was sitting at one of the pews in the room with a stained glass window. Just looking at her, you might have thought she was offering a prayer. But the words coming from her mouth were anything but prayerful. They were filled with resentment. They have plenty of money. A sullied woman. And then I never asked to end up like this. So this is what's beneath that facade. Most likely money's what she's after. All I need to do now is confirm my suspicions with them. Just what awful secrets will I uncover? I gave Giselle, sitting in the pew with her head drooped, a cursory glance before leaving the chapel. I had somewhere else to be. Bitterly cold outside air felt like dozens of needles flowing into my lungs. It had been so long since I stepped beyond the mansion's walls. A thick mist canopied the night sky, blocking out the moonlight. Naturally, the heavens did not rejoice at my leaving the house. It had been 10 years since I had seen the mansion from the outside, and it hadn't changed one bit. A gloomy scar upon the earth shrouded in darkness. Hardly the kind of place someone would enthusiastically approach. Nevertheless, it was better than that house. Yes? Who is it? Michelle. What? Michelle Boulanger? Just one moment. I'll be right there. Come in. It's a humble abode, but make yourself at home. Wow, I must say, this is rather unexpected. Just one word and I would have been up there in a heartbeat. And how was I supposed to do that? I am regrettably fresh out of carrier pigeons. Right, yes. My apologies. This man, living in a small cottage not far from the mansion, had been hired by the Boulanger family. His job, to watch over me. That said, we never actually interacted. He was tasked with keeping track of whether I was still alive and whether I remained in the mansion. The monthly package from my family was delivered to him, which he then passed on to me. It was insipidly convoluted, but it was indicative of how much they wanted to avoid anyone learning about me. Well then, what can I do for you? The manservant was visibly rattled. Afraid, too. But not because of the difference in our social ranks. I had a pretty good idea what he had been told about me. He was afraid of me. Or more specifically, my curse. People fear that which they cannot comprehend. Not just children, adults as well. They fear demons, witches, and curses. Anything impure or not of this world. But I had long since gotten used to being viewed as such. It didn't sadden me. It didn't disappoint me. It didn't pain me. Some things were too foolish to concern yourself over. Though it certainly doesn't make me feel good either. I was on some level annoyed. That woman's appearance at the mansion had created ripples in my once tranquil life. So before I got into the real reason for my visit, I decided to take out a bit of my frustration. Raise your head. There's no need to be afraid. I don't know what you've been told, but I promise I don't bite. How rude of me. You're right. My sincerest apologies.
Your job is to keep watch over me. If the mere sight of me has you trembling, what will you do if I try to run? I would have little trouble escaping.
That would be quite unfortunate. What would I ever tell your mother?
I'm not sure that would end well at all. You could lose everything you've been paid so far. In fact, you might be lucky to get out with your life.
Surely your mother would not...
You are aware of who you're dealing with, right? Michel, the cursed young son of the Boulanger family, who made a pact with the devil. I don't need a blade to take your life. You wouldn't even make it back to report anything.
Have mercy, Lord Michel. Please do not leave the mansion. Please spare me.
Only joking. I don't have the power to kill you by way of curse. The man fell silent, but the look on his face said, You are cursed, though, aren't you? Once someone's got an idea planted in their head, it's now impossible to get rid of it. I am so cursed that anyone can see it, that I need to be locked away in a dark mansion. I am here because I had a question for you, not to warn you that I plan to run away.
A question? For me?
Yes. Approximately 3 weeks ago, a black-haired woman came to the mansion. Tell me what you know about her.
I was told there would be an Abigail coming, but that's all. I don't know anything else about her. I swear, that's all I know. I haven't been told anything else.
I believe you. I never thought they would tell you anything.
Right.
He had been hired to observe me, but that's all he was. A hired hand. He wouldn't be privy to the Boulanger family's internal affairs. Take this.
A letter?
I need you to deliver it to my mother.
You could have just left it in the box from this month's package. I would have collected when I dropped off the next one.
I am in urgent need of information. Will you do this for me?
Yes. Why, yes, absolutely. I'll fetch a delivery boy tomorrow morning.
Much appreciated. Good night.
You too. Do take care. Lord Michel?
Yes?
Is it true that you don't have...
Would you like me to sew your mouth shut so you can never open it again?
No, not at all. My sincerest apologies, Lord Michel. That was horribly disrespectful. Good night.
Cursed, I most certainly am. My mother's response arrived just 10 days later. The delivery boy must have pushed his horse quite hard. It was almost exactly a month after Giselle had moved in. And shortly thereafter, on a bone-chilling night, everything came crashing down. The rift between us grew deeper, and the wall between us impossibly high. When I lay bare, the scars in her chest, and mercilessly plunged my knife into them.